dance our way out of our constriction. Gonna be freaking up and down the hang-up alleyway. With the groove I only got, we shall all be moved. Ready or not, here we come. Getting down on the one which we believe in.
Build a museum? Well, we're on the way. So on behalf of the National Museum of African American Music, I'd really like to welcome you to our sixth annual celebration of Legends Gala. But you know, I have a question. Have you ever seen a show with fellas on the mic with 1 million rhymes that don't come out right? They bite. They're never right, and that's not polite. Am I lying? So, my wife reminded me this evening that it was in 1986 when we met, and that, therefore, Dougie Fresh is the reason why we've been married for 28 years and have two boys that we're proud of, off in college and pulling money out of my pocket. And so the point of that is that, you know, this music is personal to us. This music is something that means something to each and every one of us that are here. The music that we celebrate tonight is truly the soundtrack of our lives. And so as we anxiously approach the opening of our museum less than a year from now, we are honored to continue programming such as this gala to honor the contributions of people who are truly legends. I'd like to thank our sponsors, our national chairs, our advisory board, our partners, and our staff for your commitment to this gala, and I certainly hope that you enjoy the show. Welcome to the celebration of legends.
Welcome to the stage, Vice President of Multicultural Tourism Development for the Greater Miami Convention and Visitors Bureau, National Museum Board Member, and Celebration of Legends Event Co-Chair, Connie Kennard.
Good evening, everyone. Today would not have been possible if not for our sponsors. A special thanks to our presenting sponsor, Vanderbilt University. We would like to extend our gratitude to each of our generous sponsors, Hospital Corporation of America, Nissan, iHeart Radio, Fifth and Broadway, Cracker Barrel, McNeely, Piggott and Fox, the Nashville Area Chamber of Commerce, the Don Harden Group, Metropolitan Nashville Airport Authority, Fifth Third Bank, Spotify, CoreCivic, Regions Bank, the Renaissance Nashville Hotel, and SunTrust Bank. Our efforts are possible because of your support. We appreciate your belief in our organization and our programs, recognizing the vast contributions of African Americans that African Americans have made in American culture. Thank you.
Thank you, Connie. We appreciate you and all that you do on behalf of the museum, putting up with me and putting up with us and helping get this done tonight. As she shared, this night would not be possible without the support of our great sponsors. So I'd like to take some time now to recognize a partner that really, really showcased the depth of their commitment in support of this event. The presenting sponsor of the Celebration of Legends Gala tonight is Vanderbilt University. Can I have our Vanderbilt guests over here, I think, make some noise? That's right, I need y'all to lead the party. So please help me welcome Vanderbilt University's own Chancellor Nicholas S. Zepos.
Well, what a wonderful occasion, and it's just great to see all of you here tonight as we gather to celebrate the museum, the music, and the many people behind it, and we celebrate this incredibly important place and footprint that is part of our city, that is part of our history, that is part of our nation, that needs to be front and center for celebration, for recognition, for study, and for preservation. On behalf of my many colleagues here and the entire Vanderbilt community, it's really an honor to take part in tonight's events. And we have witnessed, through Henry's hard work and the hard work of so many others, the genesis of the National Museum of African American Music over these last several years. I would like to thank everyone who worked so hard to put together and to take care of us at this event. I want to specifically mention someone from my office, Sharman Bates, who is here, who is an innovator, an entrepreneur, a partner, a colleague, and she has done exceptional work. Thank you so much, Sharman, for what you're doing. The opening of this museum will, of course, impact our city, will change our city so much for the better. It will make our state so much better, and it will make our nation so much better. It will provide not only a physical gathering spot for visitors, scholars, students, future musicians of all kinds, but also a foundation of knowledge from which the discourse about this vital part of our culture must come to the fore and must flourish. Much like the NMAAM, Vanderbilt is committed to investing and supporting our community through education and engagement. We are totally aligned with the vision and the mission of the museum. It is our pleasure, it is our privilege to embrace new institutions to partner with cultural traditions, cultural presences that enrich our story, enlighten people on our campus and in our community, and importantly, to learn about our history and to learn about our heritage. As a mark of our enduring dedication to the museum and everything it stands for, I am delighted to share that Vanderbilt will be making several gifts to the museum for different important parts, but totaling $2 million to the museum. And I want to thank Henry and Kevin for the many conversations we've had, the discussions. Thank you. That was a good slip, wasn't it? But as they say, it's not about the money. It's always about the money, right? So, but what's important is part of the gift is, an unrestricted gift. A large part is unrestricted to help. We've got to build this. It's got to get done. But then importantly, another large part of the gift is it has to be sustained. It has to be nourished. It has to be here for a long, long time. And so the other part will support the programming that will enliven the museum, that will draw visitors. There'll also be a fund dedicated, and we know there are so many donors out there, a fund to collect books, collect scores, collect recordings, collect objects that will further our shared understanding of the critical importance of African American music and history. Throughout the course of these gifts and beyond, Vanderbilt will always serve as a strong educational partner to the museum. Our facets of our partnership will include bringing our students to the museum to immerse themselves more in our community and learning about parts of our history and culture that too often are not explored, even on the campus of a great university like Vanderbilt. There'll be shared resources for scholarly research, opportunities for faculty engagement, a collaborative approach to bringing visionary speakers and performers, yes, to Nashville and to this museum. I think, as I said, getting the museum out of the ground is great, but it's gotta hum. It's gotta be alive. It has to be a living museum. I think we know that this partnership will be strong. It'll be an enduring one for Vanderbilt and the museum. But we hope, and we know it'll ignite cross-pollination, needed cross-pollination across our entire community. Across our entire community. Elevating Nashville as a cultural center and set an example for the world at large. It is done here in Nashville, Tennessee. My hope is that these contributions will not only support the museum's many exciting programs and endeavors, but it'll also illustrate that we are exponentially stronger when we work together. So I think this is a moment of pride for Vanderbilt. I think this is a partnership that will be enduring, and I think we are so honored to be able to be a contributor to something that is going to make Nashville and Vanderbilt so much better. So thank you very much. There's so many things,
David's.
There's so many things to say about the museum, but frankly, when we sit around and talk about things at Vanderbilt, we all sit around and there's a management team and we talk about what we should do and what we should not do, and in many ways, the visionary, the engine, the force behind this was really from my dear friend and colleague David Williams. And you know, I think it's interesting we're celebrating here tonight a foundational investment in an institution that is long overdue for this great city. And last night we won a national championship. And both I think whether it's Tim Corbin, I think whether it's Nick Sempos, I think whether it's Malcolm Turner, that's David. That's David's championship. And this is really David's museum. This is really David's museum. And for so many, David's family, for all of us at Vanderbilt, for me personally, there was just a big hole in our lives that we're still trying to stitch together when we lost David this past February. Now, many of you knew this. David was brilliant. Tax lawyer, executive, athletic director, and I don't know if none of you know that David, as a native of Detroit, was a lifelong Motown enthusiast. And I don't know, I mean, Alice Randall might argue, I would put him beyond enthusiast. I would say scholar. And David's lectures on Motown and America and music were standing room only gatherings. So in many ways, my vice chancellor colleague, tax lawyer colleague, athletic director colleague understood the transformative educational power of music in bringing people together and telling stories that were too often not told. So it's no surprise to me or anyone to know that David put his heart and soul into this project and that he would be so happy to see the progress that has been made. His vision, his compassion, his love of music surrounds us all tonight. And with that, I'd like to direct your attention to a short video we put together about David. Thank you very much. David's a teacher.
Every place David is a classroom.
He's just been somebody I can always go talk to.
It's in his DNA to teach. His parents were teachers. He's always teaching, even if he's not in the classroom. He is teaching. And we get many lectures.
He's always been a teacher to me. He's always guided me. He's always put me in good places to succeed.
Everything about him and what he stands for has been for the student athlete experience.
In many ways, he embodies and I think lives the Vanderbilt way. And the Vanderbilt way is where we have the right balance between academics and the athletic experience.
He helped us plan the service trip to Jamaica. It was one of the best experiences of my life.
It was something that challenged us and definitely took us out of our comfort zone, but it showed us how amazing this world is.
He cares about our success on the field, but he cares about us more so off the field.
This room is symbolic, I think, of our family, our parents, and their parents, and this commitment to a lifelong education for so many.
We were at a dinner. He invited everybody at the dinner to come back to our hospitality suite because he was going to be spinning records as a DJ.
He loves the Motown.
And one time he just yells, like, get up, dance, and my husband jumps up, and I'm like, you don't even work for him.
I've gotten used to a lot of his Motown. He's got plenty of stories, and I know a lot of people heard about his Motown.
I think he knows Lionel Richie and the Commodores from, like, Tuskegee or something like that, so he's been somewhere, he knows what he's talking about.
Of all the things, and David has done many, many things, bringing Perry Wallace home was the most important. David won't call himself a trailblazer. But he is one in his own right as the first African-American athletics director in the SEC. And, you know, what Perry did in the late 60s allows a David to sit in his seat and open the doors for so many other people.
You can only go where you're trying to go if you understand where you've been. And that's a deep part of our history. Being able to appreciate that and celebrate that was a huge win for Vanderbilt University and for David Williams.
I remember, you know, talking to David in my office, and he had just joined the team, probably 2000, year 2000. But I remember David talking a lot about our job is, as leaders, to figure out what's wrong, what can be better, and to come up with solutions. And that's always inspired me.
David, I love you. I'm so incredibly proud of you. Our whole family is proud of you. You rock, my dear. I love you.
You have been a huge influence in my life. I feel very blessed to have worked for you and alongside you. I just know that you really made a difference, and it is much, much appreciated.
David, I love you, man. You're such an inspiration, what you've accomplished, what you've done. Thank you for being the definition of a man for so many of the young men who have been here.
Dad, I'm so proud of you for everything that you've accomplished here at Vanderbilt. I thank you from the bottom of my heart for everything that you've done for me.
We wish he and Gail all the best and say thank you for your service and your leadership.
On behalf of all of Vanderbilt Athletics, thank you so much for everything that you have done, Gold Father. Anchor down and go Doors.
To Gail and the Williams family, on behalf of the National Museum of African American Music, we'd like to present you a plaque in recognition of David's friendship and his transformative impact on us, on all of us at the National Museum of African American Music. We're certain, and we want to be certain, that his legacy will live on. So Gail, if you'll please join me.
Wow. I love that man. And to be here tonight with our four children, and I'd like our four children to stand, Erica, David, Samantha, and Nick. That's David's legacy. They're amazing human beings who do incredible things every day, and I couldn't be more proud of them. I couldn't be more proud of David. Last night was incredible when we won the national championship, and how ironic, anchored down, right? And how incredible that the footage today showed the last national championship. How incredible. And to talk about Motown and how much David loved music, you know David loved music, right? I mean, how many people walked into his office for a meeting and the music was glaring and you thought, he's gonna turn that down, right? But then all of a sudden you were talking to the beat of the music he had on, right? And you couldn't wait to run out and get in your car or go to your office and turn it on as well. Or when he DJed at Vanderbilt and the poor kids all summer had to carry his three or four big bags of CDs. He didn't care anything about a playlist. He was not going to do that. He was going to carry every CD and he was going to have those kids carry them. They carried CDs more than they had to wash dishes, but it's okay. But what everything that you heard with Dave, you know he liked jazz, he liked classical, he liked R&B, he liked to look country, like even, but he'd call it country soul, right? And he probably liked, he may have liked that Billy Ray Cyrus and Little Nas on the BET Awards the other night. He may have liked that a little bit. But when David did music, you learned about the music, you learned about the musician, but he also would talk about historically why this particular
piece of music originated or became, or what was happening in history at that time. It was always a lesson that he taught whoever was around him. So fitting tonight that this amazing museum would honor him in this way. And by the way, David said, Henry, why are you honoring me? It's so many people who have been doing this collaboratively. Why are you picking me out? But he would be proud. And Nick, he would be so happy with Vanderbilt's gift. He would be so pleased to know that his beloved Vanderbilt was putting a huge stamp and having a huge impact on this museum and the future of Nashville as it relates to African American music. He'd be so happy. He'd be cool about it, but he'd be happy. I'm grateful and honored to accept this award on behalf of David. And David, you know we talk every day. But again, thank you, David, for leading again. You know, this your week, dude. You winning all over the place. I'm loving it, right? In the house, Dave, right? It's amazing. I can't thank you all for giving us this love, this kindness. This holds us up. This gives us the opportunity to find peace in this valley that we found ourselves in. Thank you for loving David. Thank you for honoring David. And thank you for loving us. On behalf of David, Erica, David, Sam, and Nick, we thank you from the bottom of our hearts, and we are truly, truly grateful and lifted by your kindness and generosity. And once again, in light of that national championship, we're all anchored down. And again, Vanderbilt, we're so proud to be in this space with you. I thank you all so much. And David, I love you.
So we have one more little surprise, and I'd like to ask Chancellor Nick Zeppos to come back out on stage if he's still back there. You know, as he mentioned, we started these conversations with Vanderbilt probably 5 years ago. And David pushed, and Lou Outlaw pushed, and others pushed. But one of the things that I'll never forget is that early on in our conversations, Chancellor Zeppos looked at me and he said, you know, Henry, you're my partner in education. And he began to talk and he added several paragraphs to that statement. But that was the one that I heard and obviously have carried with me, because what it said to me was that early on in those conversations, he got it. And he understood the powerful connection that we could make as a museum, as a cultural institution, with a research university, and that powerful combination is what can not only inform the world, but also change the world. So I want to say thank you to Chancellor Nick Zeppos.
Thank you very much. I will always treasure it as part of my recording career. Thank you.
And now, please welcome to the stage the Director of Marketing and Communications for the National Museum of African American Music, Dion Lucas.
Marketing marketing and communications for the museum. I'd like to just pause for a moment and speak briefly about the significant impact NMAAM is making in our community and around the country. Our goal at NMAAM is to educate the world about the impact and influence African Americans have had and continue to make on music and our culture. As you made your way to this room today and you walked through a series of galleries, I want you to know that we were very intentional about what you saw. So we showcased talent that was rooted in Nashville's DNA. So there's so much rich talent in this city. So we wanted to showcase that talent at the same time while we were celebrating our legends tonight. These legends are the artists who have carried our shared language of rhythm, melody, and harmony across the globe. We are dedicated to ensuring that African-American artists, like the legends we are honoring tonight, are acknowledged as well as celebrated. Prophetically, Funkadelic wrote a whole new world. Woo! Where music would be a catalyst for inclusion, which we can all agree is more than a notion in these divisive times. Their signature song, One Nation Under a Groove. It represents a call to action. It represents a guiding principle for NMAAM so that we connect and amplify the many voices that represent the soundtrack of our lives. We look forward to advancing this important work when our doors open in spring of 2020. Thank you for your continued support, and we will make Nashville a better music city once we open. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, show some love for our house band and musical director, Stanley Brown. Now, let me tell you how this needs to go. So, in the music business, this is how we do it, okay? So before we perform, this is what we do. There's something called a sound check, all right? Now, these guys have really already done this, but I kind of want to walk you through that process, and you'll see where I'm headed in just a minute, all right? Mr. Drummer, you mind to get a kick real quick? You mind if we hear that? Yes, sir, I appreciate that. Brother Brandon, you mind a little percussion here, please, sir? You mind that? Mother keyboard player, you mind giving us a little something, please, sir? Bass man, you mind talking to us a little bit? Yes, sir. Brother Stanley, you mind talking to us? Mr. Guitar, you mind talking to us? Yes, sir. Keyboard, you. Yeah. Ladies, microphone's working. Here we go. Okay. Okay. I think we need to get this going. You see, this is why we had a sound check. We want to make sure everything is everything before we get started, right? We need to get this out front of the house. So look, they're working on that. While they work on that, my point for sound checking the band was to show you that we need to sound check you. All right? We've heard from everything and everybody but the audience. Now, we're here to honor some very special people tonight. And so it's important that we give them back the energy that they have given us through decades of music. This is very important, all right? So this is what I want to do. When I say mic check, I want you to say 1, 2, 1, 2. And I'm talking about at the top of your lungs. In Nashville, you know how we get down. We cannot let these people come down here and not show them how we get down here in Music City. We call ourselves Music City, so we got to do this. Ladies and gentlemen, all right? Mic check. That's what I'm talking about. That's what I'm talking about. All right, can we get that thing going, Brandon? We got it? All right. Now to the business. The time has come to begin our Rhapsody and Rhythm Awards. Our first honoree is a legendary performer whose career has spanned over 40 years, and that career is showing no signs of slowing down now. Now listen, really quickly, I'm gonna get off the script for 1 minute. I'm gonna get off the script for 1 minute because this lady is my friend and I've got to tell you something. It's all good. So, our first honoree was at a show. You see these speakers on stage are called monitors. She tripped over a monitor on stage. After falling, she was paralyzed from the waist down and spent a lot of time in the hospital. They didn't know she'd walk again. They didn't know what the outcome of that would be. Record company said, you know what? We think we're done here. We don't want to continue our relationship anymore. But it's funny how things work. The record company got a new president. That new president said, you know what? Let's give her a shot. She took that shot, and shot she did, right to international stardom with an anthem about her life and her experiences with a song called I Will Survive. Come on, a song that defines strength, resilience, a genre, and won a Grammy for Best Disco Recording. Survive she has. I Will Survive was entered into the Grammy Hall of Fame in 2012, and in 2016, entered into the Library of Congress National Songwriter Recording Registry. That's right. Her newest gospel album, Testimonies, also anchored with a message of optimism and represents the long-awaited realization of her musical vision. Ladies and gentlemen, our first honoree is none other than Miss Gloria Gaynor. Paying tribute to Gloria tonight, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Legends Band and the incomparable Avery Sunshine.
What's up, guys? My name is Jay White, and we get to pay honor to the one and only Miss Gloria Gaynor.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Jimmy B on the guitar.
Miss Avery Sunshine.
Family, I do have better manners than to show up and honor Miss Gloria Gaynor without shoes on, but I knew with what I'm about to do, I just go ahead and skip a step. I am honored to be here to sing just a little bit of an anthem. You know, when you hear, there are some songs you hear when you're a cheering, right? And then you grow up one day and you know exactly what the songs mean. Well, I am honored to be here to sing this song for you tonight. And if you know it, you gotta sing along. This is the good mic, praise God, yes.
Yeah. Did you think I'd crumble? Did you think I'd lay? Hey! Oh, no, no! I will survive! Oh, as long as I know how to love, I know I'll stay alive!
Sunshine, presenting Gloria Gaynor with the 2019 Rhapsody and Rhythm Award is gospel legend, creator of one of the longest running cable shows of all time, the Bobby Jones Gospel Show, and the 2018 Rhapsody and Rhythm Award recipient. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Bobby Jones.
I will survive. Somebody say, I will survive. Yeah. On behalf of the National Museum of African American Music, we present to you Gloria Gaynor with the 2019 Rhythm and Rhapsody Award. Ladies and gentlemen, Miss Gloria Gaynor. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I cannot tell you what an honor and a privilege it is for me to stand here tonight and receive this award, to receive this award, to be presented with this award, to be considered worthy of this award is an honor unspeakable, because to be counted among the great artists who've already received it, and to be honored and have it a part of my legacy, to be a part of this wonderful museum that stands to help young people coming after us to know their heritage, what they have inherited, and what they have, the foundation that they have to stand on, is an honor beyond my wildest dreams. So I thank you. Thank you, thank you. Thank you to the Vanderbilt University and to the founders and the dreamers of this museum. Thank you so much for considering me worthy of being a part of this awesome legacy of African American music. I can't say enough, so thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. And it is beautiful, oh my. It is gorgeous, and I, wow. Thank you so much, and thank you to Avery Sunshine for doing that awesome rendition of I Will Survive. Thank you again.
See? You guys all right? Okay. So we're gonna keep this party going. Our next Rhapsody and Rhythm Legend Award recipient is not only a hip-hop trailblazer, but a television personality, producer, entrepreneur, and an activist. The original human beatbox. His contributions will forever be etched into the annals of music history. You already know who I'm talking about. None other than the world's greatest entertainer, Mr. Doug E. Fresh. Yeah. I gotta tell you this, like anybody that knows me before, let's just say anybody that knows me from high school, my nickname in high school was Mr. Mouth. Now, they told you before this thing started, I'm proud, I've got a couple Grammys, couple Emmys as a songwriter producer. But before I was a producer, I was a beatbox. Why was I a beatbox? Because my brother from Harlem named Dougie Fresh. I can't tell you how excited I am to be here tonight to honor this legend. A testament to his lasting legacy, he stands as one of the most actively touring musicians across all genres, averaging over 200 live performances per year. Among the many awards Fresh has accumulated over the years, he is a Hip Hop Hall of Fame inductee, a 2004 recipient of the Source Awards Lifetime Achievement Honor, and the 2014 BET Hip Hop Awards Icon Honoree. Ladies and gentlemen, paying tribute to Doug E. Fresh, please welcome DJ Mars.
I need everybody to do me a favor and get out your seats. Everybody get out your seats. It's time to take the train, take the plane, get on the highway, and go up 95 North to New York City. Everybody in the building, get out your seats. Since this is a real special moment, Dougie, I think I'm gonna bring somebody from Harlem to represent with you tonight. So, at the count of three, I need everybody in the building to make some noise, all right? One, two, three, make some noise! Ladies and gentlemen, all the way from Harlem, my man, Mr. Fat Man Scoop!
What's happening, everybody? How y'all feeling tonight? First things first, I want to say that Nashville has some of the finest women in the world. Now, Doug, you know where I got that from. You know where I got that from. You are welcome. I will talk to you later. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to do my best. The best Dougie Fresh impression that I can. So don't laugh. Don't talk to me about it later. But I'm gonna say one thing to you, man to man, and you know I've told you many a time. If there is no Dougie Fresh, there is no Fat Man Scoop. You are my father in this business, and I am honored to be here to do this for you tonight. I even went on Amazon and found the chain that you worn all the way to heaven. I am a fatter version of you, so just go with that. Are we good with that? So here's what we're gonna do, everybody, hands in the air right now. How many people here were born in the 60s? How many people were born in the 70s? Anybody born in the 80s? So then you should know hip-hop. We're gonna find out how much hip-hop you know, okay? If you know the song, you sing along. If you know the song, you sing along. If you know the song, let's go.
Oh yeah.
Let's go, let's go, let's go. Come on, come on, what? Come on.
La-di-da-di.
La-di-da-di.
Lottie!
What?
Lottie!
What?
You know what? Yo, pick this. Lottie Dottie.
We like to party.
We don't cause trouble.
We don't bother nobody. We're just the band that's on the mic.
What? And when we rock up on the mic,
we rock the mic right.
For all of y'all, keeping y'all
what?
In hell.
Come on.
Just a
what?
Smile.
What?
Enjoy
come yourself. On. Come
cause
on.
It's cool when you cause a cozy condition that we create.
And that's our mission.
So listen to what we say.
Because this type of thing happens every day.
Also, if you didn't know, this is called a show. Let's go! Everybody, if you proud to be alive, put your hands in the air if you're happy to be alive. Let's go! All my, all my, all my!
What you say?
Immigrant.
What butt?
Immigrant.
6 minutes.
Immigrant.
6 minutes.
Take it fresh, you're on.
Be quiet! All of us, can you hear?
Be quiet!
All of us, can you hear? sing along.
Let's go.
I can't hear y'all. What you say? Come on, come on. What's up with the West Side?
Pisces.
What's up with the West Side?
Virgo.
What's up with the West Side?
Aries.
Come on. If you're not on it, come on. If you're not on it,
make noise.
If you're not on it,
come on.
If you're not on it,
make noise.
If you're not on it, on your hands.
Come on, come on.
If you're not on it.
Now let's go.
If you got more hair on your head from your ears to your sleeves, even if you got a weed.
Shut 7. Can I get up? Can I get up?
Ow! Ow!
Can I get up?
Can I get up?
Can I get up?
Ow! Ow! So all my dudes that are hitting from the back, who wanna have sex with those feet to touch?
Can I get up?
Can I get up?
Can I get up?
Oh!
Ow!
Can I get up?
Come on!
Can I get up?
Can I get up?
Get it off!
Get it off!
Engine number 9.
What on that New York
transit line?
What if my train goes off the track?
Pick it up, pick it up, pick it up.
Let's go,
let's go.
Hey, go,
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 go.
Who's pressing tonight?
Who's pressing tonight?
Who's pressing tonight?
Hey, go.
Stop playing.
Keep it moving.
Stop playing.
Keep it moving.
Stop playing.
Hands up.
Keep it moving.
Hands up.
Keep it moving.
Hands up.
Keep it moving.
Hey, ho.
Nashville, make some noise! Let me explain something to you. I was a very young kid in the streets of Harlem, New York. I wanted to rap. I actually had talent. There was a DJ named Chill Will who took us under his wing. Chill Will belonged to the Get Fresh crew. I then met Dougie. As a young child, I idolized the way that he was able to do what I do up here right now. Without this man, I don't know if I could have fed my family for 23 years doing this every week on the stage around the world. I love you, brother. Come up here, man. Without you, there's no me. Without you, there's no raw bass.
Yeah. It's about that time. It's about that time to get paid. Get laid. Cool in the shade. Drink a little bit of lemonade. Let me tell you.
Yo,
I wanted this to be special.
Go Doggy! Go Doggy!
Push it through the doors. I see girls having a good time. I might.
That was fun, fun, fun. Thank you, DJ Mars. That's my brother. Give him a round of applause, DJ Mars. Yeah, we just did a new song together, having fun. And the one and only Fat Man Scoop. You see that, man? Wow, this is very interesting. I had fun with that. Well, I wanna, should I go over there or should I stay here? Stay right here. All right, well, we're gonna stay right here. So one of the things I wanna say is, which is really, really a beautiful thing. I wanna say hello to Nashville, first of all. The music city, the real music city in the world. So many great musicians, so many great artists, so many beautiful people. And I didn't get to know the brother up here. I think I met him and I was looking at the video, but I wanna send my respect to the family of the brother Dave that I seen here. I wanna say to his children and to his beautiful wife, you have my respect and I appreciate the contribution that your father has made. And any person that got a history like that, that go back to Motown, that was like losing a very valuable person. You know, history is important. You know what I mean? I mean it sincerely. And I would like to also acknowledge that my father is in here tonight. He can stand up, you know, talk about history. Stand up, Dad, stand up. You know how we do. It's my father. He's 78 years old, looking great, feeling great. And I wanna thank the Creator. I wanna thank God. I wanna thank the blessings of the Creator. I mean, I don't know. I know some people don't believe, but I really don't know how can all of this happen without some kind of orchestration from something greater to, you know, to make a lot of this happen. I really don't know. I've never figured that out. But I wore this shirt today because James Brown's daughter gave me this shirt. And this is James Brown on this shirt. This is him. And a lot of times when you get awards, you wanna talk about the great things about what you do and stuff like that. But I always say that I got love for the artists that I hear today, but I respect the pioneers that paved the way. You know, I live by that. I live by that. And there wouldn't be no hip hop without James Brown. I don't know if y'all know the story of hip hop, but it wouldn't be no hip hop without James Brown. So I want to acknowledge James Brown from the beginning. I want to acknowledge DJ Hollywood, Lovebug Starsky, the one and only Mr. Curtis Blow, Busy B, Grandmaster Flash and the Furious Five. A lot of these brothers came before me. I was the child of that generation of hip hop. You know, my mother used to let me play music in the house. My father used to let me play the music in the house. And then I couldn't have done it without my group, which was Chill Will, Barry B, which is the Get Fresh crew, and the one and only my partner, Slick Rick. And even Teddy Riley and Dennis Bell, who was a manager at the time. See, a lot of times when you see somebody up here, it's so many people that got them up here. You know what I mean? So I don't like to misrepresent that. So I'm gonna tie this up so that you can understand where I'm coming from with this. The format of hip hop, a lot of people ask me, how did I create the beatbox? Because that's one of the things that I created. I mean, rappers wasn't dancing, so I did the Dougie. Because they didn't want to dance. And I'm from Harlem, and if you're from Harlem, you're going to dance. And so the way that the beatbox was created, so that all of y'all can know, and I'm gonna make this very brief, is that there's five elements in hip hop. Hip hop is designed because of five elements, and hip hop is the body of all forms of music combined. And what I mean by that is that hip hop is pieces of everything. You'll find blues, you'll find jazz, country, rock, you know, folk, everything, because we take pieces of everything And one of the main contributors of hip-hop was James Brown. And I'm going to say this also before they acknowledge him, but also George Clinton in the world of the West Coast hip-hop. I got to tell you the truth before I go, right? You don't want me to. So this is it. I'm going to school, and I'm in junior high school, and I'm on my way to school, and the music teacher in the school asked me, what instrument do I want to play? I tell him I want to play the drums and the percussions. He said, no. I said, well, why you ask me then if you tell me? He said, you should play the trumpet. I said, okay. He said, you take home the trumpet and you play the trumpet, then afterwards what you'll do is I'll let you play the drums and the percussions. So what happened is, long story short, I took the trumpet home. How many people play an instrument in here? Anybody? You know the exercise with the trumpet was not simple. So you go home and I took the instrument home. Afterwards, they cut the program, the music program in my school. As in a lot of the urban community schools, the programs of music was cut. So when they cut it, no more trumpet. But I was still walking home every day doing the same exercises. Now, how many of y'all go back to mom and pop record shops on the corner where they had the speaker and you hear the music when you're walking down the street? So I'm walking down the street and I hear the music. So I would hear one thing play and I hear the beat in it. Then I hear the bass line. Then I'd hear the keyboards, then I hear the hi-hat, then I hear the drums, then I hear the other sounds in it. So before I would get home, and I would do this every day, I started doing like 8, 9 sounds at one time. And I really wasn't paying attention to it because it was just something that I was doing. So what happened is I went over to my boy Barry B's house, and in between playing the music, his mother used to listen to us because she liked us being in the house because we wasn't in the street getting in trouble. So what happened is I'm in there doing a beat in between, and then all of a sudden mother coming home, she said, you know, that beat that you played there sound nice. What was that beat? Barry said, it was him. She said, that was you? I said, yeah. I said, I was just playing around. So afterwards, he said, Dougie, you know what you should do? You should go down to the block party and you should call that the human beatbox. I said, I'm not gonna do that, man, you crazy. I said, nobody ain't gonna listen to that. He said, I'm telling you, you do it outside, watch. So I went outside. I got on, I was rapping, doing everything. He said, do it now. I started doing the beatbox, crowd went crazy. They couldn't even believe it was me. And that was the birth of the beatbox. Now the question is this. It's a very interesting question I've been asking myself this over the years. Would I have created the beatbox if they didn't cut the music program in the school? You see, and then I'm asking myself the question because I didn't get to play the drums and the percussion in the music class because it was cut. So I kind of created all of this because of what happened. So there's a poem that describes everything that I think we all create. And I think even when I was listening to our sister, Ms. Gaynor's situation, which I thought was, it was explosive to hear how that song came about. I think this describes what most artists, how they create. We the willing, led by the unknowing, are doing the impossible for the ungrateful. We have done so much for so long, with so little, that we are now qualified to do anything with nothing. Thank you for the award, I appreciate it. And may the Creator continue to bless you and bless your family. And I honor the museum. Thank you for having me, I appreciate it.
1, 2, 3, 4, new kicks, fly chicks. Cars in the streets, fly beats, hurting traffic. Sidewalk map, what's the bad kid? Stop it, you're ready for the 4, 5, 6. When I drop it, slipping tricks, fish and chips. If you really wanna get with this uptown, shake and make, take and break. Harlem is forever, we always get together for real.
Tell me where y'all from, baby. Tell me where y'all from. Tell me where y'all from, baby. Tell me where y'all from.
time for Dougie Fresh, y'all.
Uh-huh. You guys all right? Music City, you all right? Come on, we're having a good time. We're having a good time. All right, we got one more honoree tonight. And I just want to let you know, now after we honor this next person, make sure you stick around because we got one more surprise for you tonight, okay? So make sure you stick around. Told you, it's going to be an explosive night. All right. We've already honored Gloria Gaynor. Affectionately known as Gigi. We've already honored Doug Eve Fresh. All right. It's time for our final legend of tonight. Our next honoree is a Rock and Roll Hall of Famer and one of the foremost innovators of funk music. His experimentation with sound spawned the legendary group Parliament Funkadelic and powered a successful solo career. Credited with 40 R&B hits like Flashlight, Atomic Dog. Y'all already know. I'm talking about the one and only Dr. George Clinton. George Clinton is recognized as the godfather of modern urban music. P-Funk beats and samples have appeared on albums by Outkast, Dr. Dre, Snoop Dogg, and many others. A recipient of the NAACP Image Awards Lifetime Achievement, Clinton continues to play sold-out shows across the globe. His phenomenal career is the reflection of a true icon. Ladies and gentlemen, paying tribute to the one and only George Clinton, please welcome our Legends Band.
All right, guys, can y'all stand up? Can I get some of y'all energy, please? We gotta honor this man right. Can y'all stand up? Come on, y'all get on y'all feet. Let's honor this man right.
Mother Earth is pregnant for the third time. Y'all knocked her out. I have tasted the maggots and the man of the universe. I was not offended.
Mr. George Clinton, thank you.
I'll stay, though she'll be coming back. You know her head went out to play, but she'll be coming back. I know that my reward, when she returns, she keeps me hanging on, hanging on. I'll stay, yes I will, oh yeah, yeah, I'll stay, though friends they may ridicule, you know there is no substitute. Talk, I can endure,
but that's alright. Mother said, son,
know that I'll be
when she returns,
when she wants to come home,
I'm gonna stay right here.
Mr. George Clinton! Let me get y'all put your hands together, y'all. One, two, three!
Everybody was feeling grim.
Hey.
Everybody got a look. They were singing all over the place. Hearing it on the phone, the way you talk to my eyes.
You won't know how we party.
So what believe they when it's done. They said
tunes and funky sounds.
Say y'all, hey.
Amazing. Presenting George Clinton with the 2019 Rhapsody and Rhythm Award is Executive Vice President, Head of Corporate Banking at Fifth Third Bank, and Chair of the NMAAM Board, Kevin Lavender. Kevin!
Somebody's clapping for me. Thank you, brother. On behalf of the National Museum of African American Music, we present George Clinton with the 2019 Rhythm and Rhapsody Award. Would you please come up?
Story behind that. No, just kidding. Anyway, it is an honor to be here tonight. George cannot be here. He is very disappointed that he couldn't be here, and he has a word for you.
You know, first of all, I'd like to thank everyone involved in selecting me for this honor. I must also offer my sincere apology and regret, as unforeseen circumstances have prevented me from joining you there on this occasion. Nobody likes to miss their own party. Becoming a legend means you did something extraordinary for a short period of time, or that you did something for an extraordinarily long time. Either way, it's not so much what you do or did, but that people enjoyed it enough to appreciate you did it. It is a humbling experience, because no one starts out on this journey seeking to reach legendary status. Most start out for simple things like fame, money, women, but the ones that are able to transcend the BS do it out of love. The love you have for what you do, the love you get back from the fans and audiences. P-Funk fans have been special. I can only hope that what they've gotten from the funk is as special to them as all of them have been to me. So again, sorry I can't be there with you, but don't let that stop you from tearing the roof off the sucker. Roof! Thanks.
Even though George couldn't be here tonight, it's an honor to receive this award. Funk is so many different things, and from a little Jersey doo-wop group to where we are today, influencing artists like the Red Hot Chili Peppers and Prince, pretty much the whole of West Coast rap, and rap music in general. He's left his legacy in so many ways, obviously the music being the most apparent, and then bringing awareness to the importance of artists knowing their rights, owning their copyrights, standing up to record labels as well, which is a fight that we will continue. And hopefully in his lifetime, he will get everything that he deserves. It's been a great year for the funk. And even though funk is its own reward, these kind of rewards are nice too. So on behalf of George, thank you.
Wow, thank you very much. You know, I'm going to, as chair, take 30-second privilege and go off script for a second. Christine, Gail Williams, Dougie, before I became a banker, Mickey, I was actually a DJ. And as much as I love One Nation Under a Groove, what I told Christine I really wanted to say up here was P-Funk, Uncut Funk, The Bomb. So I got that out of me. In all seriousness, and I better put these back on to read, so apologize. Age may. In all seriousness, on behalf of the board of directors of the museum, I'd like to thank each one of you for coming out tonight. What a fantastic, beautiful, lovely crowd. We're doing something special here. And when you stop and think about a lot of things that have happened in our lives, we ask a lot of times, where were you when? Tonight, this audience, you're the first audience to be here when our building was going up. And I think that's special. You can clap for that. And being here tonight, you're not only helping us celebrate these three individuals whose sound define their respective genres, you're also supporting our mission to celebrate the history and legacy and influence of African American music, not only in the United States, but across the world. If you have been downtown recently, you may have noticed, besides just our traffic, the large sign on the side of a building on the corner of Fifth Avenue and Broadway. By this time next year, the National Museum of African American Music's doors, they will be open. By opening those doors, we will be transforming the culture and landscape of Nashville, Tennessee, and of the nation. This is no small feat, and those of you that have been around for years know that it's taken a lot to make this happen. It only happens because of the tireless efforts of a team that is committed to making this vision a reality. Can I have the members of the NMAAM Board of Directors, as well as the NMAAM team, please stand for recognition, please. So everyone give them a round of applause. I sincerely thank you, and we thank you, and we can't wait to experience what you all have created.
Please welcome to the stage President and CEO of Boyd Publishing and NMAAM board member, LaDonna Boyd.
Thank you.
Good evening. Hasn't this been a fantastic event so far? Let's give them a round of applause. So President Hicks, Chairman Lavender, Event Chair Connie Kennard, of course Dion Lucas, our MC Shannon Sanders, the entire museum staff, and of course our fantastic curators and our lovely supporters, thank you so, so, so much for all that you've done to bring this event to fruition. Again, let's give them another round of applause. And to each and every one of you, thank you for being here this evening as we honor three legends of African American music, Dougie Fresh, Gloria Gaynor, and the fantastic George Clinton, as well as take strides to become a little bit closer to the opening of this dynamic, incomparable, and necessary institution. Can you believe it that today we are approximately 325 days away from opening the doors? That deserves another round of applause for sure. In less than 1 year, we will have the opportunity to walk through the space and to see this masterpiece come to life. I know that it will be a sensory overload as we witness the sights, sounds, smells, and feeling of a dream. At this time, I have the distinct pleasure of asking all of you to continue the journey of partnership and moving the dream forward by applying your money and other resources, hello, towards the remaining financial goals. I believe in putting my money where my mouth is, which is why I'm so honored to announce that R.H. Boyd Publishing Corporation, as well as my family, are making a wonderful donation of $1 million to the museum. And we are, thank you. Though it is a big check, I have never been more proud to sign my name on the dotted line to make sure that we can bring this museum to fruition. We're also doing this to honor the legacy of my father, Dr. T.B. Boyd III, as one of the founders of this museum, and he is deeply proud of all the work that has been done thus far for this museum. I also want to announce that a portion of our donation will go towards an endowment that will support HBCU students pursuing music education. And additionally, a portion of the contribution will also be held at Citizens Bank here in Nashville, which is the oldest African American financial institution in the country, and it deserves our continued support as well. We all know that music is the heartbeat of our culture. It soothes, it excites, it mourns, it praises, and it serves as a battle cry as well as hope for the future simultaneously. We are very proud to support this museum and are hopeful that others will continue to follow suit to meet the goals of this institution that will inspire generations to come. This museum will be the crown jewel in the reign of Nashville as the It City, and it will also show the other side of the story of Music City. Every person here in Nashville and every person of color around the country has a unique responsibility to support the mission and the message of this museum. Without the black influence, there would not be bluegrass, jazz, hip-hop, gospel, R&B, neo-soul, and so on and so forth. We have impacted every genre of music and every aspect of American culture, and it's time for us to tell our story. This evening, as we honor our legends, I want to thank those that have already contributed to raising our $60 million goal. I ask that all of you join me in investing in this important opportunity. In the museum, we are the only museum in the world dedicated to preserving and celebrating the African-American musical traditions and its influence. And any gift counts. $100, $200, $500, $2 million, whatever you can do, we will certainly gladly take that. Now I want to tell you how you can make this contribution. If you look on your table, you will see this fantastic card. We're going to do like church. When you find it, say amen. Amen. Okay. Look at this. There's so many options, so many ways to give. So please make sure to fill this out. You can leave your contact information with many of the staff members that are here, and I would love for the museum staff to wave their hand so that you can see who to give your check to. Thank you. And also, we have the opportunity to make credit card payments tonight as well. There are two museum staff members that are able to take that information, Lorna and Jada, and if they're out here, wave your hand or say amen as well so that we can find you to continue to support this museum. And of course, you can give online. If you go to www.nmaam.org, you can make any contribution that you would like, and you can also set that up on a recurring payment. So please do so. Please support the legacy of this museum. Let's all put our money where our mouth is and show that this story needs to be told. I hope that you've had a wonderful evening, and let's keep this music going forward so that we can show the story of African American culture for all to see. Thank you.
All right. Now, when we started, I told you that we were going to have a phenomenal evening. Was I right? All right. The good news is we're not done. We're almost done, but we're not done. So here's the plan. And I'm going to tell you, first and foremost, it's been a great night filled with amazing performances. I'm honored to have served you as your host tonight. Hey, I appreciate that, sir. You know, it's funny because I was, and just to deviate for a moment, I was talking to somebody on the red carpet earlier, and they asked me how I felt about the museum opening here in Nashville, in my hometown. And I had to tell them, you know, it's funny because recently I've been on this thing about watching Dr. King's speeches, and I told them that in the same way that Dr. King said that America had an opportunity to live out the true meaning of its creed, I feel the same way about Nashville. And I feel that when this museum opens, Nashville can live out the true meaning of its creed or its calling, its Music City. At that point, we will truly be Music City. Just want to, and again, just off script, just want to thank the staff of the museum. They have a phenomenal staff at the museum. Henry and his team, Dion, the board, and you, the city, just the way that the city has wrapped around this. You know, I remember in the beginning, you know, with NMAAM, National Museum of African American Music, you know, and I remember saying at one point, it's important that we remember that the N is for National and not Nashville. But you know what? The way that we have embraced this, a lot of people ask why. Why Nashville? Why not Memphis? Memphis has stacks. Why not Detroit? Why not New York? Why not Atlanta? No. Nashville. So listen, with that being said, it's important. Remember, turn in your NMAAM donation cards. Now listen, you don't have to have big money. It's not about that. It's not about that. It adds up. You guys know what that is. You guys know about the little Christmas funds. You know, you guys know about the shoebox in the top of the closet. It's the same concept. Same concept. A little bit goes a long way, guys. It adds up. So before you leave, please see someone on the NMAAM staff with your donation. It adds up. All right. Thank you so much for coming out and celebrating with us. Again, it's been an honor to serve you today. We're closing this night with a bang. And guess what? I want us to go out of here partying, too. It's been live. Gloria Gaynor, Dougie Fresh, George Clinton in the field. Come on, y'all. Come on, y'all. Ladies and gentlemen, coming to the stage is a group led by the multi-Grammy nominated award-winning songwriting and production duo Claude Kelly and Chuck Harmony, also known as Lewis York, playing the official song for 2019 for the National Museum of African American Music, One Nation Under a Groove. Ladies and gentlemen, help me welcome Lewis York and their new band, the Shindellas, and Mr. Talkbox.
How y'all doing? Y'all been having a good night today? Now we're talking about the Dr. George Clinton, are we not? So we're gonna celebrate this the right way and go out the right way. So I want everyone to get on their feet for this one because it is the anthem, right? One nation under a groove. Are we ready to do this? Let's do it. On their feet, come on. To dance your way out of your constriction, yeah. Here's your chance to dance your way out of your constriction. Gonna be freaking up and down, bring up the alleyway. With the groove I only got, we should all be moved. Come on, ladies, come to this part. Ready or not, here we go. Get it now. I think I know this part, come on.
One nation under a groove. Get it down, just for the bunk of it. One nation and we're on the move. Your funkin' fuck. Hey, I think the family now. I got a question. Do you promise to funk the whole funk?
Nothing but the funk.
All right. Hey, ready or not, here. Come on. Yeah, we're on the move.
Yeah.